Hey, Mike Healy here, and I usually do these lives inside my van after I get out of the gym, but I just got a phone call from a guy, and it was too good of a call to not prompt me to do the very first Facebook Live of 2020 going into the new decade. And this was a gentleman that had been, he's in the same type of company I am in networking, and he read something online that was negative, and he talked to a couple friends and things like that. And I don't know if I was just fired up about something or whatever, and I just went off on it. But it prompted me to come up with some stuff that I think you need to hear, okay? So the title of my post here is Never Take Financial Advice from Someone You Don't Want to Be Like Financially, okay? So here's the deal. 23 years ago, when I first joined network marketing, I'm 50, I'll be 52 shortly, a couple months from now, I'll be in March. And when I was 27 years old, it was the first time I got involved in the direct selling network marketing industry. Now, I didn't know anything about it. I wasn't, I didn't go to school to learn how to be a networker or anything like that. I wasn't, it wasn't something they teach in school or anything like that. But I was basically a broke alcoholic bartender at the time. And someone said, hey, I found some way to make some extra money on the side. I mean, that was the details of it, okay? And who would have thought that, here I am, 23 years later, I've done so well financially, but I didn't have any background in it. But it was some key things that I heard some people say that changed my opinion on life and finances and stuff like that. The number one guy that I ever saw or met at the time, his name is Paul Orbison. Sadly, he passed away a few years ago. He was the number one income earner in that company, the first company I ever joined. He was averaging over $1 million a month in that company. And I remember running into him a couple times, and or he used to come to our meetings because he was from Kentucky. I'm in Ohio. It was really cool. And he always talked about never taking financial advice from someone you don't want to be like financially, because so many people, they step out onto something new that maybe they've never had it, but you will always, when you try to do something new or you try to do something that's going to increase your family, your life, your finances, usually your circle of influence, your true friends will typically encourage you. What do they call those crabs that try to pull you down when you try to get out of the bucket? I forget, sand crabs or something like that, Dungeness crabs, whatever. You put them in a bucket and the one crab that tries to grow out, the rest of the crabs try to pull you back in. They a lot of times don't want you to succeed. And here's something that I heard somebody say that I thought was great. It said that criticism is the death gargle of the non-achiever. Criticism is the death gargle of the non-achiever. There are so many people out there that can talk a good game, but never do anything to get off their butts to go out there and actually change things or make a difference or do anything different, right? Like, I've always tried things. Have I failed many, many times? Absolutely. But that's part of the process, okay? Every time I go to the gym, you fail to get better, believe it or not. You try to max weight to get stronger. It's just a natural process. The same thing happens in business, but I think too many people, they don't think about these things. Now, here's the other thing that I wanted to tell you too, is I'm in a company right now, the company I'm with, which is what's really amazing, is the fact that the owner of our company has made consistently over $1.5 million a month, okay, for years. Like, he did that with his thing. And I had somebody tell me one time that they weren't willing to pay a $99 a month membership, basically, to be part and stay part of the company. And I kind of had to laugh to myself. And I said, so wait a second. What you're telling me is this. You're telling me that you want financial change. You want financial increase, but $99 is going to hold you back. And the investment of investing in yourself just to be part of that. To me, I told somebody, I said, look, I only joined. I don't care if I actually ever made it. I've made a ton of money in this already. But to me, the $99 a month membership just to be part of the community and to listen and to learn from a person who has made that kind of income has been worth it to begin with. Like, that's to me, that was one reason I wanted to join to begin with. It had nothing to do. The opportunity. I knew the opportunity was good, but most importantly, the ability to just plug into that community and culture and the leadership principles and the things that I could learn from this guy are worth it altogether. Okay. So I said this at the very beginning, you know, never take financial advice from somebody you don't want to be financially. So here we are going into the year 2020. Perfect day right now, New Year's Day, to everybody's going to make their decisions. They're going to make their, you know, New Year's resolutions, and most people will fail at keeping those by tomorrow. In a lot of cases, right? They're going to get into their bad habits. They're going to not make it to the gym tomorrow. I already went to the gym real early. It was still dark when I was leaving for the gym, but I'll tell you this, that there is such a fine line between the people who actually make it happen and have success and the people that don't, that it's literally like this big. It's literally those people that take that slight edge thing. And the guy that I was just mentioning that runs our company, he was talking about this as well. One of the best books that I could tell you to start the new year with, that I think is one of the best books ever written, is called The Slight Edge. It's by Jeff Olson. Even if you didn't read the whole book, but you actually got the audio of it and listened to the 30-minute intro, the 30-minute intro of him introducing what's in the book is worth the book, okay? But The Slight Edge talks about those people that make those little tiny slight edge decisions to either stick with something, quit, you know, the compounding interest effect, things like that, make it so much more worth doing. Or make your life more successful than anything else. Because, you know, so this guy, let me go back to this guy calling me. So this guy reads something negative online, opportunity is in. It's the same opportunity I'm in. And the thing is, I don't want to ever discredit somebody having concerns. But I asked the guy, I said, do you know who wrote this? And they're like, well, yeah, you know, the guy was telling me this. And it was literally, it's a person completely broke, who has no business background, who's basically criticizing something. And it just cracks me up that people literally, people let the naysayers, the people that are the non-achievers, give them advice on something. Like, I'm telling you, never forget the thing. Because here's the thing, all over the place, but it's just the caffeine kicked in and this guy's phone call. But you know, I just learned never to take financial advice from somebody I didn't want to be like financially. The other thing is there's a significant difference between making a living and having a life. And I also told him this. I said, here's what I've known in 23 years of being an entrepreneur, that there are absolutely no guarantees of any kind in life. I don't care what you're doing or what you're in. If you have a job, you really don't have a guarantee that you're going to have a paycheck tomorrow. If you're an entrepreneur, you don't know if you're going to have a paycheck tomorrow. If you're, if you don't know if you're going to walk times, right? Like the Bible itself says, focus today on what you can get done today, basically. Tomorrow, worry about itself. But I always laugh. To me, it always cracks me up at the people that complain the most, or usually the ones that do the least. And criticism, like I said, is the death gargle of the non-achiever. It's because most people, it's much easier to point out flaws than it is for people to edify successes or chase those successes. So many people just are time wasters. Like the one thing why I think my business works and why I become so successful is I don't play with people. You know, I'm not carrying dead bodies across the finish line. I don't call people and beg them to go get to work. I don't call people and say, hey, what'd you do today? You know, because nobody's done that for me. Like I wake up, from the day I joined networking so many years ago, most of it came down to in my notebook that I had when I would go do presentations. This is before the online stuff we can do today. I had a little picture of my first child, Alexis, her little baby picture. And it was my why kind of thing, right? I always heard you had to have this why that made you cry. And I remember every time I opened up the thing, that was her first thing. So I don't care what kind of day I had or whatever. It was this picture that kept me going the whole time. The other thing too is back to that guy that kind of was the original guy looked up to, Paul Orbison. He said some stuff to me personally that rattled me in a way that I think is why I'm here today doing very successfully. And, you know, I'm successful in business. Is I remember telling him one time that there was really no leadership in my area. The guy that was doing the meetings left, and he looked at me and just said, "You know, Mike, it's okay to go ahead and be a leader." You know, and I never really thought about it that way. And I was like, okay. And then I can't remember how long the time period was between that. My business wasn't doing that well, wasn't, you know, going out very well or going very well. And I remember complaining to him, right? I complained to a guy that had gone through probably 10 times the adversity that I had already gone through, and he was successful. But I figured since he was successful, I was going to complain to him. And he looked at me. And he was like, "Yeah, really? Oh man, you know, that sounds tough." And he said, he just came over and he put his arm around me, and he had this really hardcore Kentucky hillbilly accent, like not like mine's any better. And he said, "You know what, Mike? Making a lot of money ain't for everybody. It might not be for you." And I was like, and it just kind of put me back here like that. And I was like, "What? Did you just say that? You know, like that to me?" And then he stops. So he's got me in shock pattern. Basically, it's the equivalent of somebody shaking a screaming person in a you know, in a panic and slapping them across the face. And then he said something to me that was the nail in the coffin. He looked at me. He said, "Mike, you got any kids?" And I said, "Yeah, I got a daughter and I got a young son. They're both, you know, they're little. My daughter's, I think my daughter at the time was maybe 4 when I said this, and my son was maybe 1 or 2. He said, "Yeah, I know business can be hard, stuff like that." He said, here's what I'd suggest, because this is something somebody told me, and I'm like, oh, this is going to be good, right? I'm getting to it. And he said, "Mike, I want you, when you get home tonight, I want you to go up there when your kids are in bed maybe, and walk up to them, and you look them, you tell them, you kind of wake them up and stuff like this, and I want you to look at them and you tell them, look at them and make with them and say, you know what? Your daddy's a quitter, and you're just not, you know, you're just not worth me going out there and doing what it takes to be successful." And I mean to tell you, I was like, "Are you kidding me?" But I got it. Like, I, at that point, like, okay, I get it. And from that point on, I very rarely complain. I just take it with a grain of salt. But those were some things that were said to me over almost 20 years ago that I never forgot, because they were the most honest things that had helped me succeed. Because so many people, you know, so many people want to get, you know, tell somebody something negative and agree with them and have their pity party. But I've learned that I can't do it, and you can't afford to do it either. The other thing too is, I remember being in a meeting one time, and this was another powerful thing, that it wasn't some guy that was making a lot of money. But the meeting was over, and this is about people speaking into you. And this guy stood there, and he was standing there at the end of the meeting, and he asked me a question about the business, some fairly important. And he asked me about the question, and a guy standing next to us that had heard the question interrupted me to start answering this guy's question, which was a little rude, but I knew who this guy was, but he wasn't really da 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 da. And this guy, this was so amazing to me. The guy that asked me the question said to the guy that answered my question for me, he said, "Stop talking." And I was like that. And he said, "I asked Mike the question." And then I was like, okay. And so the guy stopped talking. I asked a question. But then after the meeting, after it was over, I answered it, da da da, and they walked away, and it was no big deal, right? It wasn't a big deal. But what was cool is I called this guy. I said, "Man, that was pretty bold that you said that." And he says, "Here's why I said that to this guy. That guy has not earned the right to speak into my life. You have." And I mean to tell you, I was like, man, that is such a powerful statement, because I realized that by not taking advice from people I didn't respect or have the type of future that I was looking at, I was protecting myself. I was protecting myself, and that's what a lot of people don't do, is you don't, in most cases, the people that are not succeeding on a big level are listening to the wrong people. They are taking advice from people who don't have any business success. They are being mentored by, you know, the clones out there that have been doing the same thing year after year after year after year after year after year and getting the same stinking results that they complain about all the time, that they're working 2 to 3 jobs. They've never stepped out of the boat. They've never tried to do something different. They've never tried to be an entrepreneur. They're not reading any books to make themselves better, but they're willing to give you their knowledge, okay? Going into 2020, and I don't want to be on here too long, going into 2020, I challenge you to protect yourself from the naysayers, the negative Nancys, the people who aren't going to pay attention, you know, who aren't doing the things you want to be with. Learn to associate yourself with the people you want to be with. One of the greatest speeches I ever heard our owner of our company, Holton, ever talk about was the, you know, you can't fly with eagles if you're hanging out with chickens and ducks. It might have been one of the funniest things I ever seen too, because he was acting like a chicken on stage, you know, and earning your wings. Eagles fly alone. They don't go with the herds, and chickens basically stay on the ground and peck on the scraps that are left around. Eagles take it to the next level, and they're going out there and they're looking for the opportunity. They're above the clouds. They're above the storms. They're above anything, because it's a different attitude. It's a different mentality. It's a different thing. That's right, Angie. That's the Sapphire speech. One of the greatest speeches I've ever heard in my life. It was the Sapphire speech. You can look up one. I think he gave the same type of speech on YouTube. If you look up Holton Bugs Eagle speech or something, it'll rock your world, because it'll get you to change the way you think. So going into 2020, if you make a decision that you want something better, bigger, and, you know, and faster, you have to learn to disassociate yourself with the people that you don't want to be like, okay, or hang around with. I'm not saying you don't love people and you don't associate with them if they're, you know, whatever, but there's the people that are allowed to speak into my life, I protect myself from those type of people. I don't tolerate them. I don't let them speak into my life, and if I got an issue with them, I will let them know, or I just, we're done, right? That it is what it is. My wife always wondered how I could do that, and to me, you know why I could do that is because I know where my future has to be, and who I have to associate with to get to that level, and if these people are not going to add to that or contribute to that level of success, then they're not the people that I want to be part of. It is what it is. You just have to protect yourself, because there's plenty of people out there. If those people that are at that level currently want to come around and come along, then they got to start doing those things that I want to be part of. There's a difference. The people that maybe are at that level, but if you can criticize me 1 or 2 times, but if you want to join, then that's different. If you want to criticize, we're donezy, baby. We are donezy. Okay. So anyhow, I didn't mean to just go on a rant here, but the guy called me, and he almost, the gentleman that called me, he literally sounded very shaken up and very emotional about this. And he was probably going to make a decision that could have changed his future if he didn't call me at this moment, believe it or not. And for some reason, he just asked me that question, and just all these things just clicked that I wanted to share with him. But, you know, make sure that going into 2020 that you protect yourself from the negative things out there, that you associate with the people you want to be like or be with and be like. Protect your circle, okay? Because remember, I remember this guy used to always talk about how, and you've probably heard this, is that your income is usually going to match your 4 or 5 best friends' incomes. You know, birds of a feather flock together. You want to go to the next level, you have to do that. And a lot of times it comes down to investment. I mean, to me, the monthly fee that we pay to be part of the company, that's a no-brainer for me. They could add another zero or another digit to the monthly fee to me, and I would pay it willingly just to be associated with the quality of people that I'm learning from the company, just to learn the leadership principles that I've already picked up in a very short amount of time. Because I know they've made me better already, and I'm hungry for that. You know, the type of business that I'm looking for and the type of, you know, that I'm in is, we're basically talent scouts. I could care less if somebody wants to do my business. I'm only looking and sorting through the people that want to go to that next level because it's fun. I mean, it's just fun. When you're around like-minded people that are going somewhere, there's a completely different energy that gets you up every day. Like, I mean, it used to be very easy for me to sleep in till 10, 11 o'clock in the morning because I had no ambition. There was no ambition to go do anything different. But now that I've got that ambition, and I've had it for years, but especially now with what we've got, that the thing that we're doing right now, it's easy for me to wake up 5 o'clock in the morning and already be rocking and rolling and having ideas going. Like all day today, even though it's, you know, even though it's New Year's Day, all I've been doing all morning, I went to the gym like I normally do, and I went, I've already got some ideas that I'm going to implement with my business that are exciting, that are going to help people. I got some new platforms that I'm going to roll out to help my people win, that kind of thing. But, you know, I mean, to me, business, a lot of it, most of the time, success in business just comes down to the mental aspect of succeeding. Because most of the time, what most people are doing in business, it's not really hard to learn the skills that you have to do. But in most cases, it just comes down to, you know, the guy Paul used to always say, how much can you take dealing with people is how successful you'll be. And that's really a lot of times what it comes down to is just how many people are going to, you know, give you a hard time and how many, you know, people you're going to deal with and so on. But anyhow, thank you guys for jumping on here. I really appreciate you being on here. Yep, Rich, we are paying a subscription to a mentorship program. I love it. I'm going to steal that one. That's a really good, that's the way I approach it myself too. So it's completely worth it if people look at it from that perspective. So thanks guys. 2020 is your year if you decide to do it. New decade, 2020. You know, it's crush time. I mean, this is going to be it, buddy. This can be it if you go out there and make it happen. So I know I got some big plans. I'm sure you do too. Collectively, I think we can do that. So anyhow, have a good one. And I'll probably see you shortly because I'm getting the hang of putting these out here, Facebook Lives. And then I download the audio and put it on my podcast. And I upload the video and put it on my YouTube channel. So content splintering. All right. See you guys. Thanks. Have a great one. Thanks, Brett. Thanks, Angie.